initially, you know, like we used to have only physical missions, right? So on the physical mission, we used to run our applications. Like we used to install OS, whatever it is, like whether it is Windows, Mac, or like Linux operating system or Unix operating system. We used to install on the base machine. So in this particular physical server, so what are the thing it is, we used to install on this physical server and we used to run the applications. So it can be any sort of applications, we used to run it, right? So we used to run the applications on this particular physical machine. It can be a small application or it can be a huge application. It depends upon the application requirement and the hardware you are using to run your applications, right? Now the problem with the physical server is, let us say, to be simple, I'll be explaining in short. Let us say you are running, you are a Python developer or a Ruby developer or a .NET developer, whatever it is, okay? Now let us say, today I have written the code for Python 2.7. Okay. Let us say, I have written the code for Python 2.7, so I have created, I have installed Python 2.7 and also I am running my Python 3.3, whatever it is, okay? So both the Python packages can be installed and can be run parallelly. But when you are executing a Python command, you need to mention what kind of version you are using. Let us say, Python people can understand a bit. And I'll just cover all the topics, okay? So Python, when I'm running 2.7, the script which I have written should be executed according to the syntax of 2.7, right? So that I will be writing in the file and I'll be executing it. By default, when you execute Python and the particular script name, let us say s.py. So it will be executing it. So this Python by default, it will be redirected into your 2.7. Now let us say I have written a code, that code will be executed only for 3.3. So then what will it do? So we need to write Python 3.3 and then we need to execute test.py. So that is a bit tough, like for a person to remember what kind of version you have written for that particular script, right? So parallelly, you want to run multiple versions. So this is possible, but it is a bit tough to execute it. So though we are able to run, but it is a bit tough to execute the script, like whether you need to understand whether the script was written by for 2.7 or 3.3 according to the syntax, right? So that is a small problem we have in running two particular versions on a physical server. Let us take another scenario. That is nothing but, let us say have Apache web server. Apache or Nginx, whatever it is a web server. Or if you are aware of Tomcat, then the Tomcat web server, okay? So there is a web server running. So my website was pages, everything was designed in order to run on Apache 2.4 version. Let us take an example. It is used to run, whatever the application which I have written here, it will run only on Apache 2.4 version. It cannot run on any other version. Let us say, one more person has designed a website. We don't have any other physical server. I need to use the same physical server. Okay. But that particular website was designed in such a way to run only on Apache 2.4. Sorry, Apache 2.6. Let us assume higher version. Okay. So it is designed to run. This particular application is designed to run on, let us say I will write like app 3. And here I will write like app 4. Sorry, app 1. Okay, so this application one will be running with Apache 2.4 and this application will be running on Apache 2.6. So can we run multiple versions of Apache web server on a single server? No, it is not at all possible because it will create a conflict. So we cannot run two particular same versions, like two different versions of same web server cannot be run on a physical server. So then what happened with this disadvantages we have in physical server, they have created a new concept called in the market that is nothing but virtual machines. Okay. So let us look into that. Okay. So in order to overcome this kind of problems and all, they have created a virtual machines. So how this virtual machines will create? Okay. So underline bottom, we need to have a physical server, that is for sure. Okay, so obviously we need to have a physical server. Okay, let us assume this is my physical server right now. So what virtual machine will do? So on desktop, we will be running your operating system. It can be Windows, Linux, or whatever it is. I'll be running my OS. Sorry, let me draw big. On top of it, on this physical server, I will be running my operating system, right? It can be anything, just assume according to yourself. Okay, it can be Windows or Mac, or it can be Linux or Unix operating systems we have. Okay, now on top of it, you will be creating a virtual machines. So here I will create one virtual machine. Here I will create one virtual machine. So this is your operating system which you are running on a physical server, right? So it can be Windows, Mac, or Linux operating system. And this is my virtual machine. Now I will create a virtual machine and I will install whatever the operating system I want to run my Apache 2.4 version. Here I'll be installing an OS. So obviously I'll be in each and every virtual machine, you can run the OS. It is independent to your physical machine. In physical machine, I can have Windows operating system, and my virtual machine, I can install Linux, again Windows, again I can install Mac, whatever I want, I can install it. So it doesn't bother about the physical server's operating system. Okay, the physical server operating system is called as host operating system. Host operating system it is. The operating system which is running on the virtual machine is called as guest operating system. Guest OS. Guest OS. So when your guest OS is running on a virtual machine, so here I can install my Apache web server of 2.4 version, and I can run my application whatever I want. Like whatever the applications want to run on 2.4, I'll be running it. And one more thing, let us say I told you, right, there is one more website which need to be running on 2.6. So what I will try to do, I will create one more virtual machine, install the operating system, and I will install Apache 2.6 version. And then I will be running my application. So both are independent. So I have two virtual machines running on a physical server, and both are having two different applications with the two different web servers. So that is advantage we have in virtual machines. So now you are not relying on your physical server. You are creating your own virtual machine, which is not physically existing. So virtually in the sense, the devices which is created without like what do we say, physical hardware, right? Which is not physically existing is called as virtual, right? So I've created a virtual server and I'm running my operating system, whatever I want, and I will install whatever the Apache web server I want, and I will run my application. Okay, so what is the other advantage is like your OS is independent. Okay, so why we need to have an operating system? In order to talk to the hardware, a person as a human being, I know certain language. So your hardware will understand only binary language. So as a human being, I cannot understand the binary language. So what OS will do, it will convey my human readable language into binary language. Similarly, vice versa. So the binary language will be converted into human readable language. So this, for this purpose, we are using the operating system. Not only this, there are multiple ways, but this is the simple example which I can give for you. Okay. So this is how we have the physical servers, operating system, and then running the guest operating system and running your applications, right? So the problem with the virtual machines is nothing but, so that is a common problem. Like if your physical server is crashed, you cannot access your virtual machines. That is for sure. What are the technology you take, whether it is containers or whether it is virtual machines? If your physical server is crashed, you cannot access your virtual machines because they are running on your physical server. Okay. So that is one thing we need to remember, both for containers as well as your virtual machines. Okay. So one more disadvantage we have in virtual machine is nothing but, if you want to create your virtual machine, at least it will take 20 to 15 minutes. Right, 15 to 20 minutes around, or it depends upon the OS level. Like it depends upon the ISO also. Maybe it will take half an hour based on network speed and all these considerations which you take, like configuring IP address and everything. Hardly it will take like 30 minutes or 20 minutes to complete your OS installation. Okay, remember, I hope there are developers in this class. And for developers, let us say he is writing some code, he want to test in some particular server. Okay, immediately he want to test it. He has an emergency case where he has written the code and he need to test it. Okay, so what he need to do, he need to build a server. Let us say he need to contact to the operations team and he need to ask them to create a virtual server or whatever it is and give the access to the particular developer, right? And he need to wait for the person or further confirmation from the operation team to get server access. Okay, but remember, waiting for a developer for such a long time will be heartbreaking, right? So he need to test the code immediately, but he need to wait for the approvals and all. So these many things need to be undertaken. Instead of that, that is a one second disadvantage we have in this virtual machines. Okay, but here we are talking about another scenario which I am going to discuss right now. Let us say your physical hardware is having a 16 GB of RAM and your virtual machine wants 8 GB of RAM, right? And you have allocated it. Now your application which is running in this particular virtual machine, it is not using the 8 GB. It is using only 1 GB or 2 GB of RAM. So what happens? Like now your 6 GB of RAM is unnecessarily allocated to your virtual machine, right? So this is the disadvantage, another disadvantage we have in virtual machines. Unnecessarily you are allocating some resource to your physical RAM to your virtual machines, which is called as virtual RAM, and it is not using completely. It is using only 8 GB of RAM in that. And nowhere you cannot adjust your RAM dynamically in a Oracle VirtualBox or whatever you take. Okay, either you need to shut down the system and reduce the RAM and then start your system. Okay, that is one thing we can do it. But here, so similarly, if you talk about something like this virtual machines, we have so many disadvantages, and okay, we have advantages, but comparing to the resource allocation and everything, we have certain disadvantages. Okay, so now let us talk about containers. So what this container does and how it will overcome your virtual machines. Okay, so from here, if you take virtual machines to Docker containers, whatever it is, the containers concept. So here also we will be having either physical server or a virtual machine. Docker can be installed. The containers can be created on a physical server, can be created on a virtual machine, or can be created in cloud. Okay. So if you have a server in cloud, you can create, you can install Docker and you can install, you can create containers. Okay. If you have a dedicated server, you can install the operating system, install Docker and create containers. If you have virtual machine, it is the same scenario, right? So whatever I mentioned, so it was discussed in the chat room and saying that if your applications, the number of applications I will be talking about here. Okay. Let us say this can be any medium. It can be a physical server or virtual machine. Let me write about physical server. Okay. Okay. So in this physical server, you will be running your operating system and all, everything is fine. And after that, you will be installing LXE. Like initially we used to have Linux containers. And after that, they have built a Docker. So Docker is nothing but an application which is used to create a containers, right? Coming back to Docker's containers, let us say your Docker will be running on a physical machine. Okay, a physical machine, you have certain OS, let us say it is Windows or Mac, whatever it is. We can install Docker on Windows system. Your base machine is Windows, you can install Docker. If your base machine is Mac, you can install Docker. And if your base machine is Linux or Unix, you can install Docker. After installing Docker, I have created a containers. Okay, so what are these containers? So containers are nothing but a lightweight, what do we say, servers, which doesn't have any operating system. It doesn't have any operating system in the container. So what it does, what it has, so how it will run your application. So it will have the libraries and binaries which are required for that particular operating system. Let us say there is a Tomcat or Tomcat web server, whatever it is. Okay, Tomcat 8, whatever it is. So this Tomcat 8 need to be installed on CentOS machine. CentOS operating system, that is CentOS 7. Okay, so what I will do, I will create a container with CentOS 7. Okay, so what this container will have, it will have the libraries and binaries which are required for CentOS 7. Okay, it will have the libraries and binaries which are required to run your application. Okay, then how it will talk to the hardware? Because I need to have RAM, CPU, hard storage, networking, and everything, right? So without having operating system, I cannot handle it. Okay, so how your application will handle this? Now this container will handle it. So this container doesn't have an operating system, so it will convey the message to the physical operating system. Okay, so a container doesn't have any operating system. If someone asks you an interview question or whatever it is, if someone is asking like, Does container have any operating system? No, it doesn't have an operating system, but it has the libraries and binaries which are required for that particular operating system. Okay, because if you want to run certain commands, you need to have libraries and binaries, right? Similarly, to run your container, we need to have the libraries and binaries installed. When it wants to talk to the hardware, then it will convey the message to the Docker, and Docker will convey the message to your physical operating system, and then it will allocate the resource, and then it will give it back to your containers. Okay, so this all happens in the container, and containers can be created within fraction of seconds. Let us say you are a developer. So developer is keep on like changing the code, and he need to test it on frequently. Okay, and what happens, like Docker containers, you can delete in a fraction of seconds, second you can create it. If you want to test a new mission, let us say a developer is working on virtual machine and a developer is working on a containers. Okay, this is testing the same application, and now you are testing your application. Unfortunately, something went wrong in the operating virtual machine, and again you need to recreate a fresh machine. At least it will take 5 minutes to 10 minutes to create it. Okay, and in the container, within 2 seconds or 3 seconds, we can delete it and we can create a fresh machine, fresh container, with all new applications installed. Okay, and we can build our own application. Let us say if you are using a virtual machine, I need to create a virtual machine with Apache installed. So okay, let us take it will take 5 minutes to create, or 2-3 minutes to create a virtual machine, and in order to install Apache web server, it will take at least 5 minutes, depends upon the internet connectivity, or it will take 2 minutes. And but in the containers, you can get an container which is already Apache installed, no need to install from our end. That is called as image. Here it is called as ISO. Using ISO only we will build the virtual machines, right? Here using images we will create a containers. That image itself will be having an Apache created. Okay, so now there is no need to install Apache web server from our end. Directly this container will be created with Apache installed. Directly you can run your application and test it. So that is the advantage for the developers who are working on a project. Let us say you want a Python server. So directly we can create a Python container which is already Python installed with the specific version, and then you can run your Python code. So there is no need of waiting for the operations team to create it. If you install Docker on your local laptop, you can test the application. Whatever the application is tested here, that can be tested in production server also. It will be working as same. Okay, some people, what developers will think, so that application which is tested in this particular physical its own server will not be working on production servers. So now it is not like that. So you can test your application on your local laptop with Docker installed, run in a container, and run your application whatever you want, and same can be applied on your production servers. So these are the advantages we have in Docker. Not only that, let us say your application is running with huge number of hits. Let us say it is a Snapdeal or Flipkart, whatever it is. Okay, so when these applications are running on a container, it requires a RAM, and this RAM will be changing dynamically. Sometimes it will be low and sometimes it will be high. Let us assume your Flipkart at night time will be using less, at midnight 3 o'clock to morning 6 o'clock, right? So it will be using a less RAM on the physical servers. When it is on peak times, like after morning 10 to afternoon, like evening 6 o'clock or somewhere, so many people will be accessing your Flipkart website. So it will be number of huge hits, and it requires more CPU and RAM. So what happens? It will be, if you don't have enough RAM allocated to that particular server, your application will be hanged, obviously, right? But in Docker's containers, your RAM will be increased according to the requirement. When it is not required, it will reduce the RAM resource, and when it is required, it will increase dynamically according to the requirement. Okay, but it cannot cross the physical server limit, right? Okay, so according to the physical server, whatever the RAM you have, it will allocate and it will increase dynamically. Okay, we can also set a container saying that you need to use only 2 GB. We can also do that. Those are called as limitations, resource limitations that can also be set. But by default, your Docker containers will use a resource dynamically, whatever resource it is, whether it will be RAM, CPU, or whether it is storage, whatever it is, it will increase dynamically. Okay, all this will be taken care by your I just want to tell in class, but all this particular technology will be taken care by your LXC technology, Linux containers, and C groups, and then which is also called as namespaces. So these are the underlying technologies of Docker. So basically, we'll be teaching about this particular concept, and then we'll be entering into the Docker technology. Okay. So if you look at Docker architecture, let me draw a small diagram. So this will be your physical server or virtual machine. Okay. You'll be installing Docker on it. Now you'll be installing a Docker on it, right? So after that, you will be running your virtual, like your containers. Okay. Some containers can be huge size or some containers can be small size. It depends upon the application you are running, right? So now this containers has some application. Now, when Docker is creating a container, first of all, it will download the image. So image is nothing but when you create a physical server, when you want to install a operating system on a physical server or virtual machine, we need to have an ISO, right? Similarly, in Docker, so when you want to create an application or when you want to create a container, you need to have an image. Without having image, you cannot create a container, right? So containers, containers will be created. So containers will be having the libraries and binaries which are required. Libraries and binaries which are required to run your application, okay, according to the operating system, okay. And after that, storage, resource, and everything will be used according to the physical server. So we are not bothered about it right now. So network. What about the network? Okay. Network is nothing but it will create a bridge. That is nothing but software bridge. Okay. So underlying it will create a software bridge here. Okay. Which is by default called as bridge zero. Bridge zero interface. Okay. So this bridge zero interface will be connected to your physical Ethernet card. That is nothing but let us say ETH zero. Whatever it is, ENP zero or whatever it is. That is ETH zero. Okay. So this physical bridge, this virtual bridge will be connected to your physical interface. And when someone is creating a container, one IP will be allocated from this particular bridge. And this IP will be allocated from here. Let us say this bridge is having a network series called 192.168.56.0/24. Okay. So now this container will be having an IP address called 192.168.56.3. Let us assume that. So when your Docker is created from this particular bridge, it will allocate the IP from this particular network series. And this bridge will be connected to your physical link card. So that's the reason directly from container, when you want to connect to Google or some like website on internet, this packet will be flowing from here, this particular interface, container interface to the bridge, and from bridge to the physical interface, and physical interface to the external world. That is how your network will be flowing in the Docker containers. Okay. So this is all about Docker. So now let us see, there is one more concept called Docker Swarm, Docker Machine, and Docker Compose. So these topics we'll be discussing on in the class. So what is Docker Swarm? Docker Swarm is nothing but a cluster technology where if you want to handle multiple Docker machines, see, this is called as Docker Engine. The package which we install on this Linux servers like or Windows or Mac, this is called as Docker Engine, the package which you are going to install. Okay. So when you have multiple Docker engine servers, whether it can be physical server or virtual machine, all the servers you cannot handle individually, right? So it is a bit tough to handle. So I need to create a centralized server. From the centralized server, if I try to create a container, it should talk to the Docker engine and it should create a container. So what are the servers you have? Docker engines you have, you'll group the servers together and you can handle from one particular centralized location. That is called as Docker Swarm, which is called as cluster technology. Okay. Cluster is nothing but grouping the servers together under one particular platform. Okay. So here also, instead of handling individual Docker engines, all the Docker engines can be handled from single layer. That is called as Docker Swarm. So Docker machine is nothing but, let us say if you want to install a Docker of same version on multiple 10 servers at a time. Now we can do from Docker machine itself. Docker machine will contact to that particular server, the 10 servers, and it will install Docker engine for you. Okay. So on the 10 servers with equal version, whatever the version it is specified, it will install with the same version on all the 10 machines. So that will reduce the burden of the operations team in order to install the Docker, right? When you install Docker machine. Docker Compose is nothing but creating YAML files. So we need to write some YAML files, nothing but orchestration. So orchestration in this sense, whatever you want to create a container, you will be writing in a file. Okay. That particular file is nothing but YAML file. So you'll be writing, I want this particular network, I want this image, this particular storage need to be created. Everything you'll specify in the YAML file. And once you use Docker Compose, automatically it will create a that particular container according to the resource you have specified in the YAML file. That is called as Docker Compose. So in order to do that, we need to write a YAML files, and then we need to use a Docker Compose command. Okay. So these are the things we have, topics we have in Docker. Okay. Docker engine. In Docker, what we are the topics we are going to discuss is nothing but Docker engine, Docker Swarm, Docker Compose, Docker machine. So these are the topics we have in Docker. If you are running your Linux server here, let us say your physical server is running with Linux, you cannot create a Windows container. In virtual machine, if your physical server is Windows, we can create a Linux servers and we can create a Windows servers and all. But in Docker's, if your physical server is running with Linux, you cannot create a Windows container. If you want, you can try it. After this class, if you have some basics idea of Docker, try to create a Docker container, Windows container on a physical Linux server. It is not possible. That is the only disadvantage we have with Docker. So when we have these many advantages, that single disadvantage doesn't matter, right? So that is a major difference we have. Okay. So let us talk something about Kubernetes. So Kubernetes is nothing but we will be having a master server. Okay. So let me draw the diagram first. So these are called as worker nodes. Worker, or just now in new versions, it is called as nodes. Okay. So now this master will be talking to three nodes. This will be talking to this particular three nodes. Okay. So this node is called as master. This is called as entire system is called as cluster technology. Kubernetes is a cluster technology. Okay. So the topic which we are going to discuss is like Kubernetes. Kubernetes cluster in this sense, from this machine, I will maintain all these three machines, right? Individually, it is not required to go to each and every machine and create a container. Now from this machine, I will try to create a container. Not only creating containers, we have other advantages, okay, in Kubernetes. Okay. Now this machine is called as master. Okay. So these machines are called as workers. Let us say it is worker node one. So this is called as worker node 2, and this is, let us say, it is called as worker node 3. Let me take one example. If you still have doubts, you can interrupt me and ask me. Okay, don't wait for till the completion of the class. If you have any questions, just interrupt me, unmute your mic and ask me. Okay, so let us say this is master and these are the worker nodes. Okay, now when you want to create a container, you will execute a command from here itself. So what it does here, we'll have certain services like Kubernetes -API. This is one package we have, and then we will have Kubernetes controller. Okay, you before, right? Docker can be installed on physical servers or virtual machines or in cloud. Here also, Kubernetes can be installed on physical servers or virtual machines or in cloud. Okay. Yep. So let us say this Kubernetes API, Kubernetes Control Manager, and Kube Scheduler. Okay. When you are executing a command to create a container, this particular master server will contact to each and every worker node and will see which is having a resource to create a container. So who will take care of this? Your kube scheduler will take care of launching the container on particular node, worker node. Your kube scheduler will decide, will take a decision on which particular worker node we need to launch, because it should see the resource, right? If you don't have resource here, then it will contact here. If you don't have resource here to create a container, then it will talk to the third node. Here also, if you don't have, then it will fail, saying that we don't have enough resource to create a container. Okay, but it will give a try to all the nodes. So this is the advantage we have in kube scheduler. What is kube control manager? Kube control manager will take care of maintaining this cluster. Okay, so whether this node is working or not, it is properly integrated to the particular master or not, it is properly integrated to the master node or not, whether it is online or not, everything will be taken care by your control manager. Control manager, in the sense, it will manage your cluster, whether master is running properly or not, whether your worker nodes are running properly or not, all the services are running properly or not, like your kube API, kube scheduler. So here we'll having some particular package on this particular machines, worker nodes. We need to install Docker. Obviously, Docker is the basics. If you don't know Docker, you cannot understand Kubernetes. Okay, so here we'll be installing Docker. Okay, and here also this node will be installed with Docker. Okay, here it is not required to install Docker, because in master node we don't launch any containers. Directly we launch on the worker nodes. If you want to launch, you can install Docker in this particular machine. After installing Docker, we also have Kubelet. Kubelet is one of the package we have. Okay, so also for your kube scheduler, will talk to the kubelet, not to the Docker. Your kube scheduler cannot talk to the Docker directly, so it will convey the message to the kubelet, and kubelet will talk to the Docker, and Docker will create a container, and Docker will give the container creation, everything, you know, using Docker. So Docker is the main component to create a container. Okay, but how to create a container, this kubelet will decide. This will send the data to the Docker, and Docker will create a container according to the instructions which are sent by your kubernetes. Okay, so this is the Kubernetes concept. Orchestration, in the sense, why Kubernetes is called as orchestration, in the sense, we will be writing a YAML file. Okay, we will be writing a YAML file. Okay, in this YAML file, we will tell what kind of container you want to create, on which node, what should be the port number. Okay, what should be the image you need to use. Okay, what should be the volume, in the sense, storage, what kind of storage you want to use, what should be the limitation on the RAM, CPU, everything will decide in the YAML file. Once you execute a command, let us say there is a command called kubectl create hyphen f, let us say test.yaml. So when you execute this command, what are the okay, so when you execute this command, automatically it will take the YAML file. What are the things you have specified in the YAML file? According to that, it will create a Docker container, which is called as pod. So here we don't call it as container, we will call it as pod. Pod, in the sense, group of containers. So under pod, we will be having a group of containers. Let us take a simple scenario. Okay, so here it will create a pod. In this pod, we will have containers. Okay, so this group of pods will be grouped together, and then it will create a layer that is called as pod. So pod will be assigned with an IP address. So you will be contacted to the pod. In the pod, you will be contacted. So pod will take care of conveying the packet to the specific container. Okay, based on port numbers and all that is high level. We'll discuss in the class. Okay, but what is Kubernetes? Is nothing but in Kubernetes we can create an orchestration. We can build your pods, services, and your deployment. What are the other advantages we have in Kubernetes? In Kubernetes, let us say you have created an application, okay, that is running on this particular Docker. This particular worker node one. Let us say, unfortunately, due to some reasons, this particular worker node is down. It is not accessible. Your OS is crashed. Then what about the application running in this container, in this worker node? Immediately it will create a container in this particular worker node. Okay, when this particular worker node is not available, whatever the applications are running in this particular worker node, that containers will be moved to this particular worker node or this particular worker node according to the resource we have. So that is advantage we have in Kubernetes. That is one advantage. And the other advantage is nothing but, let us say that is okay, when it is down, it is going to this particular worker node. Now it will take some latency. Okay, to overcome this, we can also have one more other advantage. That is nothing but replica in the sense, I will try to create an application. That application will be created here, here and here. Okay, when this application is down, it will access data from here. When this application is down, it will access data from this worker node. So in the front end, it will create a load balancer. Using this load balancer, either it will contact with this application or this application or this application running in this worker nodes. If any one of the application is down, it will get the data from the second application or third application. So there is no downtime in the application. So this everything will be managed by your Kubernetes. So that is the next level of advantage we have in Kubernetes. Okay. W. So that is the second advantage we have in Kubernetes. Like we can create a pods, we can run the pods at any application, like you can install whatever the application you want in the pod, which is nothing but container. And then that pod can be run on multiple worker nodes. If any one of the worker node is down, you can access your application from the second worker node. So this is the second level of advantage we have in Kubernetes. And the other advantage is nothing but you can scale out and scale in. If someone knows about AWS, we have auto scaling group, right? Auto scaling in the sense, either you can increase the, we can set a limit saying that if my CPU is increasing more than 80%, I need to launch one more instance automatically with the same template, right? That is what will be in the auto scaling group. If it is less than 50%, again, I need to remove the instance which is created additionally. So this is called as auto scaling, auto scale in and scale out. That can also be applied in Kubernetes. Okay, let us say there are three applications running on three worker nodes. Due to some reasons, your load is getting increased. So then what we can do, we can launch one more container with the same data. So this launching one more container, we can also specify that, set a margin threshold value saying that if my CPU is increasing more than 80%, automatically I need to create one more container. So that also can be specified in Kubernetes. So we have a lot more advantages in this. Okay, so this is all about Kubernetes. See how it is different from Docker Swarm and Docker Kubernetes is nothing but Docker Swarm, we don't have all the technologies we have in Kubernetes. Okay, like replication we have, but we don't have anything like pod, like launching similar containers into one particular layer. That is nothing but pod. We don't have anything like service. Service is nothing but exposing your Docker container to the external world. Like from outside also we can access it. Okay. And then we have other advantages like creating replicas, inbuilt load balancer. Okay. And then auto scale in and scale out. Okay. So we have these many things in Kubernetes. Okay. And we can create an orchestration like YAML file we can write, and we can launch a containers or service or deployment or replication. So everything you need to write a YAML file. YAML file is not too tough. Just we need to write a syntax, key value pair it is. Either you can launch your resource objects in the sense which are like launching a pod, launching service. These are called as objects. If you want to launch this objects using Kubernetes, we need to learn YAML file or JSON format. It is just simple, key value pair it is. Okay, just we need to write a YAML file and then build your pods, which is called as orchestration. That's the reason Kubernetes is called as orchestration. Orchestration in the sense, writing something into a file and launching it is called as orchestration. Okay. Now it is not required manually to specify, I want this RAM, this is my CPU, this should be the hardware. It is not required. Just write whatever you want in a YAML file and then execute it. This is called as orchestration. And see, it is advantage, this Kubernetes is like can be used by developers, testers, and operations team. Testers can create a containers and they can launch, they can test their applications here, over here. Developers also can do the same thing. They can develop a container with all pre-requirements which are to run your application, which can be created and can be installed. Okay, and operation system, obviously, operation system has a lot of advantage of creating containers, launching it, maintaining it, and we can also build open cloud on this particular Kubernetes, which is under process. Now, the current technology which they are trying to do on Kubernetes is nothing but they are trying to build a cloud on Kubernetes. That is like OpenStack cloud. If someone has heard about OpenStack, so they are trying to build OpenStack on Kubernetes, which is a cloud, which is called as network cloud. And before coming to the Kubernetes, we need to understand what is networking, overlay network, what is VLAN tagging, everything we need to learn. So I'll be teaching all the pre-requirements which are required for this particular technology to learn. Before learning Docker, we need to understand VMs. That I'll be teaching it. And after that, we need to understand what is network. So what kind of networks we have and what are the advantages, what is bridge network. We need to learn about it. We need to learn what is image, what are layers and all. After teaching that, then only I will enter into Dockers. After Dockers, the complete Docker engine is done, then I will go to Docker machines. After Docker machine is done, then I will move to Docker Swarm. Once a Docker Swarm is done, then I will move to Docker Compose. Once this particular, when you are perfect with Docker, this particular technologies, then I will start with Kubernetes. Without teaching Docker, I cannot enter into Kubernetes, because here also again, I need to teach about Dockers, right? So instead of that, we can start about Docker first, the complete entire technology we have in Docker, and then we will enter into Kubernetes. Okay, in Kubernetes, then we can see what are the other advantages we have apart from Docker. Okay, like how to create a YAML files. YAML files, don't worry about YAML files. It is not a script. It is just a syntax which we need to follow.